Good evening, students, once again for our class number 30 today. So we have two more weeks, as I said before, okay, for next two Fridays, and we'll finish the New Testament survey. So today we'll cover the book of Hebrews, and the key chapters will be chapter 11 and chapter 12. So let's bow our heads in prayer. Father, we just thank you. We praise you, Lord. We worship once again for this amazing opportunity. Bless these thoughts as we teach, Lord. Give us deep insights from the book of Hebrews. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. So the author of the Hebrews is unknown. Okay, the author of the Hebrews is unknown. Okay, and the date is around 64 to 68 AD is somewhere this book was written. Okay, the authorship, many suggest, have been made of the author of this anonymous book. There are both resemblance and dissimilarities to the theology and the style of Apostle Paul. But Paul frequently appeals to his own apostolic authority in his letters, while this writer appeals to others who were eyewitnesses of Jesus' ministry. Okay, so these are three suggested authors. Some believe it could be Paul. Why they say it is Paul? Because the early church believed he was the author of this book. Number second reason is because of the characteristics of closing of an epistle is similar to the writings of Apostle Paul. Thirdly, because of the expression of the just shall live by faith. The expression is an Old Testament quote by Habakkuk chapter 2:4, which is used three times in the New Testament: Romans 1:17, Galatians 3:11, and Hebrews chapter 10 verse 38. The argument here is that in as much as Paul used this expression first two times, he probably used it on the third occasion here in Hebrews. So probably they think Apostle Paul could be the author. And the fourth reason, because of Peter's statement in 2 Peter 3:15 and 16. Here Peter states that Paul had written to the same people he was addressing, the Jews of dispersion, in 1 Peter 1:1. Peter then refers to Paul's letters as scripture. The book of Hebrews is one only New Testament book which fits this description. Okay, so that is another reason. Because it was written from Italy by a friend of Timothy who was in the prison at that time, this could tie in with Paul's imprisonment as recorded in Acts 28. So anyway, these are some reasons people believe that Paul could be the author. Some believe it could be also Barnabas who wrote the book of Hebrews. There are two reasons why they believe Barnabas. Because he was a Levite, and the book of Hebrews seems to have been written by a Levite. And second reason is because of the comparison between Acts 4:36 and Hebrews chapter 13 verse 22. Okay, some believe also Apollos could be the author of this book, because the eloquent Greek style in the Hebrew, because of the Old Testament quotes in the Hebrews are taken from Septuagint, while Paul usually quoted from the Hebrew Old Testament. Anyway, it is safest to say, as did the theologian Origen in the 3rd century, that only God knows who wrote the Hebrews. Okay, so when Bible doesn't clearly tell us the author, we don't have to put in somebody's name and say he could be the author. So, but only God knows who's the author. So when we get to heaven, we'll know who's the author. Till then, we'll just enjoy the book of Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 10:11 reveals that it was written before the destruction of the temple by Titus in AD 70. So somewhere it was written before the destruction of the temple when Titus was ruling in AD 70. The theme is, Coleridge said that Romans revealed the necessity of a Christian faith, but that Hebrew revealed the superiority of the Christian faith. This thought is expressed in the use of the comparative word better, which occurs 13 times in the book of Hebrews. So let us imagine a conversation, okay? Let us imagine a conversation between a Hindu and a Christian. The Hindu listens intently as the Christian briefly summarizes the earthly ministry of Jesus Christ. At the conclusion of the message, four basic questions might come up to his mind. Number one, why did Jesus have to be born? The answer to this question would be, no man had seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he had declared him. Why did Jesus have to die? who gave himself for our sins, that he might deliver us from the present evil world, according to the will of God and our Father, in Galatians 1:4. The third question would be, why did Jesus have to be resurrected? And if Christ not be risen, then is our preaching vain, and our faith is also vain, in 1 Corinthians 15:4. Why did Jesus have to ascend? The book of Hebrews. Okay, that's what the book of Hebrews is. Okay, why did Jesus have to ascend? Because the answer is the book of Hebrews. The book of Hebrews presents the holy full discussion in the New Testament of Christ as the believer's high priest. This is very interesting. Okay, the book of Hebrews gives the exact discussion on the New Testament of Christ as a believer's high priest. It answers the questions, whatever happened to Jesus? And the several theories are here as well. Like Jerusalem, however, this would seem doubtful because of Hebrews 2:23, because of Hebrews 6:10, 10:34. The readers of this epistle were apparently able to minister to others, but the Jerusalem church was poverty stricken in Acts chapter 11:27. Because of Hebrews 12:4, but the Jerusalem church has suffered martyrdom in Acts 7:59. Because of there is no mention of the temple. Okay, there are several theories, okay, of the destination from where this letter was written. Some say it could be Jerusalem and different views about it. Okay, because there is no mention of the temple, possibly it could be Rome or Ephesus. Anyway, the book of Hebrews has been called the fifth gospel. The first four gospels were like what Christ did on the earth, that is John, Matthew, Mark, John and Luke, which gives us what Christ did on this earth. But the book of Hebrews describes what he is now doing in heaven, okay? That's the theme of the book of Hebrews. Here is a short outline. Christ is better than the Old Testament economy. Hebrews chapter 1 to 10 is very doctrinal. First 10 chapters are doctrinal, where it reveals Christ is better than the Old Testament economy. Then in chapters 11 to 13 is a very practical aspect where Christ brings better benefits and duties. And chapter 11, of course, also speaks about faith. Chapter 12 speaks about hope. And chapter 13 speaks about love. So we picked up two important chapters for this class today. It's Hebrews chapter 11 and then later Hebrews chapter 12. So it'll be a very exciting class. Be tuned with me as we learn this class together. Faith is the greatest power in the world. Now Hebrews 11, that's what the subject of Hebrews 11 is. The readers of this epistle were being tempted to go back into Judaism. The problem of this church in that the writer is addressing is that the readers, the one who's reading this book, were tempted to go back to Judaism, put their faith in Moses instead of going to the perfection, that is maturity. They were going back to perdition or waste in Hebrews chapter 6. So Hebrews chapter 11, all Christians are called to live by faith. So that's why Hebrews 11 talks about every believer need to walk by faith. So the description of faith is what we'll cover in the first three verses of Hebrews chapter 11. It says this is not a definition of faith, but a description of what faith does and how it works. True Bible faith is not a blind optimism. Very important, okay? A true Bible faith is not blind optimism or manufactured hope so feeling. That's not Bible faith is. Neither it is an intellectual assent to a doctrine. True Bible faith, listen to the statement, true Bible faith is certainly not believing in spite of evidence that would be superstitious. But true Bible faith is confident obedience to God's word. Can I repeat that? True Bible faith is a confident obedience to God's word in spite of circumstances and consequences. No matter what my circumstances is, no matter my what is my consequences is, I'm confident in obedience to God's word. And that's what biblical faith, true faith of the Bible is. The faith operates quite simply. God speaks and we hear his word. We trust His word and act on it no matter what the circumstances are and what the consequences may be. The circumstances may be impossible and the consequences frightening and unknown, but we obey God's word just the same and believe Him to do what is right and what is best. Faith is not some feeling that we manufacture. Okay, it's not like a kind of feeling that we try to show off. No, it is a total response to what God has revealed in the word. It is a total, complete response to what God says it in the word. Three words in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 2, 1 and 3 summarize what true Bible faith is. It is a substance, it is an evidence, and third one is a witness. Okay, these are three important words that summarize a true Bible faith. So we'll quickly see into what these three words are. Number one, the substance. The word substance means literally to stand under or to support. Faith is to a Christian what a foundation is to a house. It gives confidence and assurance that he will stand. So you might say faith is a confidence of things hoped for. When a believer has faith, it is God's way of giving him confidence and assurance that what is promised will be experienced. Okay, so that's very interesting. Okay, I have a confidence, it's like a foundation. Faith is a foundation. Okay, the word evidence, the second word is evidence, which simply means conviction. This is an inward conviction from God that what he has promised, he will perform. A God-given faith in one's heart is a conviction that he will keep his word. Very important, okay? His faith is not something that I produce. It is within me. The Holy Spirit helps me to walk by faith. Okay, so God-given faith in one's heart is a conviction that will keep his word. That's what evidence means. It's a conviction. And thirdly is witness. King James Version says, obtained a good report. An important word in Hebrews chapter 11, it occurs not only in verse 2, but twice in verse 4, and once in verse 5, and once in verse 39. The summary in Hebrews 12:1 calls this list of men and women so great a cloud of witness. They were witnesses to us because God witnessed to them. In each example cited, God gave witness to person's faith. This witness was his divine approval on their living, on their lives and their ministry. It's very interesting, isn't it? A great cloud of witness where God is giving us a witness. They are witnesses to us because God witnessed to them. It's not they stood by their own, but they were witnessed by God. God witnessed to them, and that's where these are the witnesses for us. The writer of the Hebrew makes it very clear that faith is a very practical thing in spite of what unbelievers say. Faith enables us to understand what God does, and faith enables us to see what others cannot see. As a result, faith enables us to do what others cannot do. I like that. Let me repeat that. Faith enables us to understand what God does. Isn't that amazing? When we walk by faith, it enables us to understand what God does for my life. Number two, faith enables to see others what others cannot see, but we see by faith. Imagine a man of God doesn't see anything what is ahead, but he trusted God's promises and moves. When Jesus said, go and preach the word to the uttermost parts of the world, no idea what would be ahead, but we go out by faith and we see the results because we believe in the promises of God. As a result, faith enables us to do what others cannot do. A lot of people want things to seen by sight and they move on. But God says, for a believer, when you don't see things yet, believe, greater are you. No, we walk by faith, and that's amazing. People let laugh at these great men and women when they stepped out by faith, but God was with them and enabled them to succeed to his glory. In that today, even people laugh when we walk by faith. When we say we go to this place to plant a church, people laugh. What is this man talking? How is he going to do it? And we say God has told us to do, and we go by faith, and we see God being faithful because we walk by faith. The best way to grow in faith is to walk with the faithful. I like that, isn't it? Walk with the faithful. That's how you walk in faith. The remainder of this chapter is devoted to a summary of the lives and labors of great men and women of faith found in the Old Testament. In each instance, you will find the same elements of faith. God spoke to them through His Word. The inner selves were stirred in different ways, and they obeyed God, and He bore witness about them. I love that, isn't it? The four aspects of faith. God spoke to them through His Word, and something happened, a deep conviction in their heart, and they obeyed God, and they bore witness about them. So here we'll see some examples of these great men who walked by faith, the demonstration of faith. Like, let's think about Abel. You know, his faith was worshiping. You know, the background story we see in Genesis 4, faith, by faith Abraham worshipped God. No, and he offered a better sacrifice. And we see also Enoch, like he had a faith walking. Enoch walked with God in the wicked world. I like that, isn't it? In a wicked world, here is a man who walked with God. Now, before the flood came, he was able to keep his life pure. Enoch was taken to heaven one day, translated or carried across, and seen no more. He walked with God. One special call, I believe, he said, like Enoch and God walked together. They walked and talked and walked and talked. When Enoch almost reached God's throne, and God said, why don't you stay back? And he stayed back. And it's so true, isn't it? Enoch had an amazing walk with God. Now, what is a walk with God? I just keep in tune with, like, somebody who's walking with me. That's what Enoch did. He just walked with God, and he was lost in the fellowship with God. Now, recently we were traveling to Palghar for a mission trip, and we were in a fellowship, so much involved in the fellowship, that we reached Vapi, almost Gujarat. And that's like, you know, like that's what happened to Enoch. He walked and talked and reached heaven, and God had him there. So while Abel died a violent death, Enoch never died. God has a different plan for each one who trusts Him. Don't think what happened to you will happen to somebody. God has a different plan, isn't it? Like God rescued, like if you look at Acts chapter 12, begins with James dying, and then Peter is rescued, and Herod died. Like, isn't amazing? Like, God's ways are different. You can't put your name into somebody's testimony. God is differently, works differently for each one of us. What you could do, I cannot do. What I could do, you cannot do. That's where we are. We need each other, because each portion is valuable. And God has each plan for each one in a different way. And we need to allow that. Don't try to manufacture somebody's faith or to try to be somebody. Be who you are. Understood? This is very important. Are you listening? I hope you're listening to me. This is very important. Don't try to be somebody. Be who you are, the way God made you to be. And there's a joy when we live that way, because that's what God's plan for your life and my life. Okay. Noah was faith walking, since nobody at that time had ever seen a flood or perhaps even rainstorm. Noah's actions must have generated a great deal of interest and probably ridiculed as well. Events proved that Noah was right. The patriarchs, the Abraham and all these great men of God, they had faith waiting. The promise of God and His plans for the nation of Israel. The nation began with the call of God to the man called Abraham. God promised Abraham and Sarah a son, but they had to wait 25 years for the fulfillment of the promise. Very important, can I say this? Like, sometimes God fulfills the promise in a moment. Sometimes He keeps us and teaches us to wait. And like, it doesn't mean God keeps us in waiting, doesn't mean He doesn't fulfill the promise. It says in Jeremiah, the one who looks at the word looks for it to be performed. And God is looking at the word that will come to pass. So that's so important. So have faith. Sometimes God delays are not denials. He is the one who promised, He will accomplish. Waiting is one of the most difficult disciplines of life. Yes, yet true faith is able to wait for the fulfillment of God's purposes in God's timing. But while we are waiting, we must also be obeying. By faith, Abraham obeyed in Hebrews chapter 11:8. He obeyed when he did not know where he was going. He lived in tents because he was a stranger and a pilgrim in the world and had to be ready to move wherever God spoke. Unbelief asks, how can this be? In Luke 1:18-20, but faith says, how shall this be? Amazing, isn't it? Like, these are very powerful words. By faith says, how shall this be? Abraham believed and obeyed God when he did not know when God would fulfill his promises in Hebrews chapter 11. In Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and Joseph, we have four generations of faith. These men sometimes failed, but basically they were men of faith. They were not perfect, but they were devoted to God and trusted his word. Okay, so the patriarchs did not have complete Bible, and yet their faith was strong. They handed God's promises down from one generation to another. In spite of the failures and testings, these men and women believed God and he bore witness to their faith. Moses had a faith warning. Moses was fortunate to have believing parents who hid their baby's son from the authorities. Okay, this account is given in Exodus chapter 2. The three great themes related to faith are seen in the life of Moses. First, the refusal of faith. In Hebrews chapter 11, Moses' refusal of faith led to the reproach of faith. Finally, there's a reward of faith in Hebrews chapter 11. Darwin's Hamner said, Moses chose the imperishable, saw the invisible, and did the impossible. When we trust God, we get what God can do. When we trust ourselves, we get only what weak people can do. When we trust God, we see what God can do in our lives. So Joshua and Rahab is another powerful faith story of faith winning. The account of the conquest of Jericho is found in Joshua chapter 2 to chapter 6. Not only was Rahab delivered from the judgment that fell upon Jericho, but she became the part of the nation of Israel. She married and gave birth to Boaz, who was an ancestor of King David in Matthew 1:4-6. Imagine a pagan harlot becoming a part of the ancestry of Jesus Christ. This is what faith can do. Various heroes of faith we see throughout the Bible, and in Hebrews chapter 11, 32-40, faith can operate in the life of any person who will dare to listen to God's word and surrender to God's will. Can I repeat this? Faith can operate in the life of any person. It could be you, it could be me, who will dare to listen to God's word and surrender to God's will. Who would dare to listen to God's word and surrender to God's will. Gideon was a frightened farmer whose faith did not grow strong right away, but did later. Barak won a resounding victory over Sisera, but he needed Deborah the prophetess as his helper to assure him. The story of Samson is familiar. Jephthah's story is fascinating. It is not possible for us to examine each example of faith. Even the writer of the Hebrews stopped citing names after he mentioned David and Samuel. There are examples in the Old Testament of men and women who won the victories. Refer to the Hebrews chapter 11, 33-35. The transition in Hebrews chapter 11, 35 is important. Not all men and women of faith experienced miraculous deliverance. Some were tortured and even died when they walked by faith. The writers of Hebrews 11, 36-38 records the fact that many unknown men and women of faith were not delivered from difficult circumstances, yet God honored the faith. Faith enables us to turn from the approval of the world and seek only the approval of God. That's what faith is. It takes us away, turn our faces towards the approval of the world and seek only the approval of God. Okay, so last few thoughts before we close this class is stay, that is Hebrews chapter 12. Now, the author is writing, okay, telling the audience of this letter to keep running. If the Apostle Paul were alive today, he would probably read the sports page of the newspaper and follow the progress of various teams and athletics. Isn't that true? Many of you like reading the sports. I like to read the sports. When I get the newspaper, first thing is I turn to the first page and then the last page. Okay, where the sports is. Okay, that's what Apostle Paul would do if he was alive today. The several athletic references in his letter indicate his interest for sports. Of course, both the Greeks and the Romans were keenly interested in athletic contests, not only for their physical well-being, but also for the honor of the towns and countries. It was a patriotic thing to be a good athletic and to bring glory to your country. The writer of the Hebrews combined these two themes of athletics and citizenship in Hebrews chapter 12. The atmosphere is that of a foot races in the arena. We can see the runners laying aside the training weights and striving to run their races successfully. Some get weary and faint, while others endure to the end and win the prize. First, the writer pictures the race in Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 to 13. Okay, he says, 1 to 3 says, and they emphasize citizenship in the heavenly city, Hebrews chapter 12, verses 14 to 29. In the minds of these readers, these two themes would go together, for no one could take part in the official games unless he was a citizen of nations. So first, he emphasizes on the race. Number two, he emphasizes on the citizenship that we have in heaven. So the Jewish believers who received this letter were getting weary and wanted to give up, but the writer encouraged them to keep moving forward in their Christian lives, like runners on the track. Keep moving, never stopping, keep moving. Okay, and he gives few things. Number one, why should we keep moving? He says, look around at the winners, the great cloud or assembly, mass of witness were introduced to us in Hebrews chapter 11. One of the best ways to develop endurance and encouragement is to get to know the godly men and women of the Old Testament who ran the race and won. If you're having problems with your family, read about Joseph. If you think you have a job problem, look at the life of Moses. If you're tempted to retaliate, see how David handled this problem. So we have a cloud of witnesses. For every problem, there's an answer in the Bible where people walked and did. He said, look at all the winners. Look at around the cloud of witness. And all that keeps us going and finishing the race. And then look at yourself, he says in verse 1b. Athletics were used to wear a training weights to help them prepare for the events. No athletic would actually participate wearing the weights because they could slow him down. What are the weights? Everything that hinders our progress. They might even be good things in the eyes of others. I like the good statement. A lot of good things in the eyes of others could also be weight, can stop us from going forward. Set your eyes on Jesus. Don't worry about the applauses of the people. Set your eyes on Jesus. A winning athlete does not choose between good and bad. He chooses between the better and the best. We could also get rid of the sin that easily entangles. A lot of good things. I said that in recent devotion. You know, I was talking to somebody and I was sharing this, so important, like, sometimes good things, the details of life, they're all good things, they're all important, but those things can be entangling us so that we could slow down in our race, and we need to have a priority in our lives and we look unto Jesus. And thirdly, so there's a witness around us, and be careful about the weight. Okay, look at yourself. What is holding you back from going forward? And thirdly, don't put your eyes on somebody. Recently, I was hearing a message from David Jeremiah, and he was saying about a runner who was like winning, and almost the last leg of his winning the race, he turned back to see whether another runner is going to overtake him. That turn cost his life, and the other person won the race. And even today, this is an amazing story. I couldn't get the details here, but it's so true. Like when we are running in the race, we are not in a competition. Listen very carefully. Our believers are not running in competition, but everybody have their own track, and we are looking unto Jesus, because we are not running for a victory. We already won the victory. Our eyes need to set for Jesus Christ, And that's what the author says. Look at Jesus Christ. He is the author. I like that. He is the originator of my race and our finisher of our faith. I like that. It's not my faith or your faith. It's God's faith who originated in me when I put my faith in Jesus Christ. And then he is the one who began a good work in me will complete it. So he is the author, originator, and the finisher of our faith. Jesus knew that he would be exalted to heaven in glory. So the joy that was set before him would include Jesus completing the Father's will, his resurrection and exaltation, and his joy in presenting believers to his Father in glory in Jude 24. Throughout this epistle, the writer emphasizes the importance of the future hope. The readers of the Hebrews are prone to look back and want to go back. The Hebrew writers, the Hebrew listeners of this book, they want to go back. They want to go back and also want to, you know, look back. And the author is saying, look forward, look unto Jesus. But he encouraged them to follow Christ's example and look ahead of faith. The heroes of faith named in the previous chapter lived for the future. And this enabled them to endure. Like Peter, when we get off our eyes of faith of the Savior, we start to sink in Matthew 14. Since Christ is the author and the finisher of our faith, trusting him releases his power in our lives. I could try to follow the example of some great athlete for years and still be a failure. Can I repeat it again? I could try to follow the example of some great athlete for years and still be a failure. But if in my younger days that athlete could have entered into my life and shared his know-how and ability with me, that would have made me a winner. Christ is both the example and the enabler. As we see Jesus in the Word and yield to his Spirit, he increases our faith and enables us to run the race. What an amazing, like that's awesome that we look to. Like, let's think about the three things. We have a cloud of witness. Okay, we look behind the cloud of witness who are able to run the race. Number two, we look to ourselves, what are the things that is pulling me down in my race? And thirdly, our eyes are upon Jesus Christ. So this is the book of Hebrews, a book of faith. So what an amazing classes. Two more Fridays and we'll be through. Let's close in prayer. Father, we just thank you once again. Thank you for all the students who are watching this class. Hope you once again you spoke to us, Lord. We thank you and we minister to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.